Hello, everybody. Welcome to this Thursday's webinar, where I will talk to you about the importance of proper gullet width, or also known as channel width. Now, this is a topic which is very often spoken, and sometimes people get confused because they say, oh, I heard it was just a fad, and now we go narrow again. And I wanted to take the opportunity to talk to you about it. What do people say? When I say people, is scientists who study the physiology, anatomy of the horse, biomechanics of the horse. Specialists could be also people who sell saddles, just like us, and why we believe the saddle should be narrow in the channel or wide in the channel. And specialists could be also the body workers who work on the horses. So without further ado, let's start at this today's webinar. And I hope everybody has a chance to click on the page and get ready to listen to today's webinar. Well, like always, I'd like to start with this little video. I kind of have a great memories of New Zealand. This is where we got our product of the, of the Innovation Award. And I always remind myself how many people are out there with so many questions, good questions. And this is what this is all about. We want to give you answers, logical answers. Of course, there's opinions, like so many people have opinions, and like everybody has a belly button, we have opinions, but then there's science. And who am I? You know, why would you listen to me? So myself, for you folks who know me, welcome back. For you folks who have not met me yet or have not seen this episode or any webinar of ours, my name is Jochen Schleese. I'm a certified master saddler. I'm also a certified saddle ergonomist. I was a three-day event rider, and I'm a founder of 9 related equine industries. I'm very proud to say that I'm a publisher of a best-selling book. We are winner of numerous industry and business awards, and we have been featured on Discovery Channel and other cool TV shows. The neat part is we have measured over thousands and thousands of horses over the last 45 years now. I can't believe how fast the time goes. And we kept the records, you know, and the neat part about the records is to see what happens here. Is it just because in South Africa, the horse looks like this? In South America, the horse looks like this? In North America, the horse looks like this? Well, It's a very easy to see a common pattern here. And one of them is that the horse, just like humans, can be left-handed and right-handed. And all of us riders would like to make sure that their horse, what they love, or their hard horse, or the horse they train, is protected and it's not damaged from bad-fitting saddles, bad chewing, bad training, bad feeding, bad care. So we all do our very best, but sometimes we don't know what we don't know. And sometimes we get very confused when some people say, oh, you know, the channel is not as wide. It doesn't need to be wide. The question is, why do we make channels in the first place? You know, and that's the question again. Why is it so important to have the right channel width? What is too wide? What's too narrow? So if we follow Xenophon's theory, which means a young horse needs to be trained carefully to build the proper muscles, and the horse needs to be able to stretch long and low and able to use his nuchal ligament system. Here's the nuchal ligament system. The horses can lift the weight off the forehand by making this red line here. This red line here is the nuchal ligament system. So more the horse is sitting underneath, and gets the weight, the hind leg underneath the sternum, Okay, the easier it is for him to do the canter period, sliding stop, etc. pp. So this is obviously the ultimate goal. And in the beginning, we obviously have to, before the horse has all the back muscle, have to train the horse in a certain way that the horse has a chance to develop the back muscle. So many, many people call this as the proper training, the classical training. I call it the only training because it has something to do with physics. So the nuchal ligament system, you can get this, the collection this way, or like it's been taught from masters to masters over thousands of years, if the neck is nice and long and low, highest point the withers, nose in front of the vertical, then the horse and the rider is sitting in the balance point. Then the horse has the chance, the horse has the chance to lift his back. Because let's face it, the horse is not able to get his haunches underneath if the back doesn't come up. So if the back doesn't come up, how is that hind leg come underneath? And how can we protect the horse from long-term damage? So if the muscles are not there, we need to ride long and low in the way the judges, and sorry, the coach has taught us, and the horsemen have taught this over the thousands of years. If not, then look at B, horse B. Look how much he's on the forehand. Horse back is hollow. Okay. When is the horse back hollow? When the horse's back sore. And when is the horse back sore? When you ride or train too hard, shitty, rolker, hyperflexion, or have saddles what hurt the horse in the back. The horse will not go against pain. It's a flight animal, goes away pain. And if the horse goes away from pain and hollows the back, look where the hind leg is. Far, far away from the ability to get light on the forehand. This is what we all after. Okay? We all want the horse's back to come up and the haunches underneath. And then the leg comes underneath. And then the leg is nice and free in the front. Now, a good friend of mine who is a berider, and then he became one of the top veterinarians in Germany, if not in the world, in my opinion, is because he constantly research, and the amount of wisdom this man has is just phenomenal. So he is a big, big lecturer when it comes to proper riding your horse so it doesn't break down in the middle. And what else sits on the top? The rider. And what's between the rider and the horse? The saddle. So what if I would tell you that there are trigger points on the horse's back? No matter how good you ride, no matter how expensive your saddle is, no matter how good you train, whatever method you do, the horse will not bring the back up. This is the longest back. Every rider knows. I want a horse what has a supple and soft back muscle. This is a locomotion muscle. This muscle here propels the horse forward, not carry. Many people think, oh yeah, the longissimus muscle carries it. No. This here is the muscle where the saddle sits on it. Where the horse carries you with is with the nuchal ligament system, the red stuff. Okay. When the haunches come underneath, then this cable system makes it able for the horse to use the muscles, the top line, nice and stretched, the longissimus dorsi, and then he can engage with his hind leg. Okay. So the abdominal muscles here, he contracts, and then this pelvis tilts under, and then his hind leg come underneath. I have worked with many professionals in the world. Dr. Karen Liebrand from Holland, she talks about to mention dressage. And I love working with scientists because a riding veterinarian, just as Gerd Heuschmann or Karen Liebrand, is they understand the physiology, anatomy of the horse. In the end of the day, when the leg goes forward, the upper arm pushes the shoulder blade upwards, backwards. How do you think this shoulder slides under the saddle? How is that possible when you girth it up? It is only possible if the saddle stays out of the way. How can it stay out of the way when you sit on top and the girth is on? Well, there's different philosophies. But the way that I have it done for thousands and thousands of years, they say never put any pressure in the lumbar area. Here's the back. Okay. And now look at the spine. You see the spinal processes and you see those little points here. You know, that's where the rib attached. There's a rib head. And then on the side, there's a longus mostorosi. Then on top is the ligaments. And then we want to stay off the spine. Okay, this is not in fashion. This has a function. You do not want to sit on the cartilage of the horse. You do not want to sit on the rib heads of the horse or on the spine or on the lumbar area, right? So saddles have to be designed thousands and thousands of years to sit nice and wide. Look at how wide the weight-bearing surface is. And they always had this nice wide channel until the tree became narrow and narrow. Look how wide that is and look how they're there now, okay? So what happened? Why are so many horses suffering in silence? Why do we see these horrible narrow channels? Okay, the horse tells you, look at the eyes, the ears, the mouth, they don't lie. It's absolutely ridiculous when people think, oh, this is just a fad. This can be any size. Oh, if it's too wide, it hurts the horse's spine and the saddle will crush down. Well, yeah, of course, if you make the channel so wide that the spinal processes touches the saddle, that's horrible, okay? But the first of all, let's think about where should the saddle sit? Should it really sit on the multifidus, on the ligaments, on the lumbar spurious processes, or on the cartilage? If the saddle doesn't hover and float over the horse, where should it sit? Doesn't that make sense that it sits on the longest muscle, which is very thick, in the middle of the longest muscle, also known as the belly of the muscle? It's a huge muscle. It's really, really thick. So if we say, okay, it shouldn't pinch the withers, it shouldn't dig into the cartilage, how is that now possible for the horse to move and the shoulder to come underneath the saddle when the rider is on top and the girth is tight? You see a horse from the side and you see the pink bar. This is the area that's the middle of the longus mostorosi, on the top of the ribs, not on the cartilage, not on the lumbars, not on the spinal processes or multifidus. Okay, so this is where your contact of the saddle sits. And then you see six little stars. And these six little stars, these are spinal nerves. Give you a good example. If you touch your funny bone, your pinky hurts. All the way to the pinky, you feel this electric shock. When you tickle the bottom of your feet or somebody else touches your feet, you may not like that. Most people are very ticklish on the bottom of the feet. Why is that? Well, because there's all the nerve endings. Okay, so when nerve endings get touched, you do a jerky kind of a reaction. If you ride with the saddle, because somebody says it doesn't matter, right? You have a nice narrow channel, the horse doesn't care. And you say, okay, my horse is always such a horrible horse. It always has wide in the eye and ears go back and mouth is open. I don't care, okay? What do you think the muscle do when you sit on those spinal nerves? Okay, so you can try it. You can run your fingertips on the left and right on the spine, and then you will see how the longus muscle contracts. Okay, instantly this muscle twitches and contracts. What will happen when the long muscle contracts? Well, we know, not like that. Here the longus muscle stretches like this. If the long muscle contracts, okay, neck goes up, back goes down, hind leg goes up. Now, if you desire, if you really want to ride hollow with the horses disengaged and all the weight on the forehand, well, then ride with a narrow channel. If you say, no, I don't want that, then follow what the masters did for years and years, thousands of years. They always stayed away from ligaments, nerves, and sensitive muscles like the multifidus. This is horrible. Now, the question is, why? Why did the industry change to saddles who are so bad now that universities write papers on it, that the modern English tree cripples the horse from today? Okay, why today? Well, we have horses now who are bred much more hypersensitive, right? We want more electricity, more thoroughbred. And with that comes, of course, sensitivity everywhere, not just on the rider's calf. So if I have a tree what is so narrow in the rail, okay, then I have very little spinal clearance. Okay, so now follow my mouse. See how there's a gap right there? The middle rail doesn't even sit anymore and doesn't distribute any pressure. So the panel literally sits only in the front and in the back. And check this out. Look how wide the trees used to be in the middle. Okay, that's when the oars were ridden with a knight shining armor and had much, much weight. Look at the width of the bars. Look at this one here, how wide is in the middle. And today's modern saddles, horrible. What I don't understand is that some equine professionals say the saddle has to be hollow in the middle. So picture this, there's two veterinarians. The one veterinarian says, this is a long muscle, okay, and it needs to be nice and soft and supple, and the weight should be nice and even distributed. So when the horse goes walk, trot, canter, and the rider does sitting trot, we have a nice weight-bearing surface and very low pound square range. Now another veterinarian says, no, no, no. The saddle has to be hollow, bridging, which means it only touches in the front and the back. That way the saddle doesn't move. And when the back comes up of the horse, then it has even contact. So I believe veterinarian number one, because veterinarian number two makes no sense to me. Because if you push digging in the front and digging in the back and not in the middle carrying at all, just for a brief moment when the back comes up, that's higher pounds per range. And a flight animal, any muscle will compensate by tightening because it will atrophy. And wouldn't you know, where do you see the white hair in the atrophy? In the front of the saddle, in the back. Very rare you see atrophy in the center. Treeless saddles or bareback riders, you see white hair in the middle, but never on treed saddles, saddles with saddle trees. You always see atrophy underneath the front and the back. So the question is, if you believe on veterinarian number one, who says, yeah, it should be nice and even, why have the saddle tree to become so narrow? Because we have more and more riders, female riders, when you put them in the cast, you see there's not a lot of space between the upper inner thigh. These muscles here, what connect to your thigh, to the front of your pelvis, that here, you can see the shade of the thigh, there's little space. So saddles are made by men, for men, 4,000 years. And in 78, majority of the rider are women. Oh, I want a narrow twist, I want a narrow twist, I want a narrow twist. So the tree makers make the twist narrow, narrow, narrow. The twist is what's between where this muscle is, right there where the bars is. So when you look from the top of the saddle, it's not the seam. Many uneducated saddle fitters still call the seam the twist. The twist, if you talk to riders, trainers, people who complain about, oh, the twist is wide, always will refer to an inner thigh. Unless you sit sideways, you're leaning with your thigh sideways on top of the seat, then you may call that seaming the twist. Right? The twist is the rail. Okay, so the rail obviously is much, much narrower now these days. And that causes a huge problem. Now we have osteopath, chiropractors, veterinarians who says, well, in order to get the weight from the bar of the saddle, let's make the gullet narrow because otherwise the bar hangs in the middle. So if I make it wide, the bar does not touch in the middle of the panel and only touches on the front and back across white hair, but I have a wide channel, yay. If I have the gullet, what is narrow, but now the bar touches the center, I have a way to a narrow gullet. What do? I sit on these little spurs. I sit on the spinal nerves. I jeopardize the... So how can I win? How can I win? What is the right way? Well, if you speak to companies who sell saddles, they have a different philosophy of saddle fit. There's approximately 9 different saddle fit philosophies. One of the saddle fit philosophy, you see, oh, we believe a clothespin fit. Because if the gullet is nice and narrow, the saddle doesn't go left or right. Again, let me show you this. I cannot emphasize this enough. Let me just blow this up so you really get an idea what I'm talking about here, okay? This is the vertebrae. This is where the nerve comes out. The nerve comes out between each vertebrae. This is a very important muscle, the multifidus, ligaments. Have you ever hit the back of your hand? How much does that hurt when you hit the back of the hand, the tendon? It takes forever. So if you think a saddle with a narrow channel is the solution, kiss your horse's bye goodbye. No pun intended, we'd run into kissing spine. Okay? We cannot put any pressure. We should know this. We learned that from our ancestors. There is a reason why all saddle had 4-inch wide tree width. Okay? There is a solution. You could have a saddle what is narrow for the rider and wide for the horse. Okay? But if you ignore the gullet width, this seminar is all about how important is the spinal clearance, channel clearance. So stay off the ligament, stay off the spine. I mean, there is tons of ways you can see kissing spine or problems. And today, surgery is really inexpensive, and they can do this in the barn and cut the overriding spinal processes, okay? And then they cut that open. But what is down there? If you go down, follow my mouse. What's this thing here? That's a hole. And when the hole gets smaller, okay, that's a normal size. It gets smaller and smaller and smaller because of kissing spine. Then that pinches the nerve. All of a sudden you have massive issues. So the horse tries to deform, tries to get away. All of a sudden your horse goes way back. It starts to veer from one side to the other. And you see huge problems. Most of the time you see horses who are ridden in narrow gullets, really low in the back, from the croup down to the front, behind the saddle, low, low back. They have huge issues in the sacroiliac joint. Don't believe my words. Talk to professors, talk to people who did an oath, do no harm. And when they look at saddles, when they look at horses, they don't care what breed you have or saddle they have. They just look at, yeah, if the horse has 4-finger clearance for their spine and the saddle is only 3.5, guess what? You're playing with fire. Okay, sooner or later, something will happen. I don't believe any more opinion. I follow science. You know, there's so many top veterinarians in the world, you know, who really dedicate themselves. This lady here, Dr. Sue Dyson, wrote the Ethergram. Now, how do read the horse's facial expression of pain? You know, Dr. Sue Dyson from South Africa, who traveled the world many times and worked on many different continents, always says you cannot train pain. Dr. Michael Weishaupt says the importance of the twist in contact to proper saddle fit. You know, they talk when the rails get narrow, we get seeing massive pressure right here, massive pressure. We have nice gullet, but with shitty saddle trees, we have massive pressure. So obviously everybody's confused and obviously everybody says, what am I going to do? Is there an out? So first of all, think about it. We must avoid pain and damage to the horse with ill-fitting saddles by following science and not opinion. I like this quote. Odia, our sales manager from Schleese, sent me this. It's a really good quote, you know, and it made me laugh. So I want to share this with you. If you are not a science and you disagree with science about science, it's actually not a disagreement. You're just wrong. Science is not truth. Science is finding the truth. When science changes its opinion, it doesn't lie to you. It learns more. So that's what researchers always do. Very good friend of mine who has 2 PhDs, he says to me, Jochen, my job as a researcher is to prove my theory wrong. We can do better for these horses. And for me, you know, if you see the texture of the skin and muscle, you know, from horse to rider, right? So think about it. The horse, look at how thin the skin is of a horse versus a human. Who would have thought about our skin is thicker than the horse's skin? They're sensitive, okay? So if I would like to have a horse where lasts long, okay? Always had these bars, this nice white weight-bearing surface, go with saddles, would fit the horse anatomy and not somebody's opinion. horses will not always fight and bite. You have horses who give up. This is a very sad picture. This horse just gives up. Typical, you can see the neck here. The horse thoracic sling is compressed. Typical sign for narrow channel is when they have these holding lines here. Okay. We don't have to do this to our animals because in my 45 years, you know, we can do better. I have seen beautiful horses who really develop nicely. And if I have a horse what has these massive movements, you know, you look how these muscles contract here and how it goes back. Now think about it. How is the saddle supposed to slide underneath when you sit on top of the saddle tree and girth it up? The only way to do it if the horse brings up the back. Okay, if the horse brings up the back, then the spinal processes all separate. And if the saddle tree is wide enough through here, this is the middle where the saddle tree is, then it lifts the saddle and the pressure is away. Okay. If I want to see that freedom, okay, only if the horse's back is up, you will see a saddle what allows here a floating and not a gripping and not a pinching. This kind of a floating will not happen if your gullet is too narrow. You know, this is damaged horse from people who do not follow signs, who have opinion, who just believe in close pin fit. Again, the reason why my books are titled Suffering and Silence, because too much opinions, follow the sign fact, don't give up, don't get into cognitive dissonance. There is a solution, there is an answer, you know, and the answer is just simple. We have to make last century's findings in today's modern saddles possible, so you can have a saddle where you have a nice wide channel and you have the bars sitting completely on. For example, the PSI panel has a nice, here you see the weight-bearing surface totally away from the spine. You find very rare computerized saddle pads who have proper images like this, away from the shoulder, away from the spine. Simple, because they either have not a computer pad what is contoured, or not, it's just one big mat. For me, a computerized saddle pad has to have a wither cutout and every square inch needs to be lit. Okay, here again, narrow channel, bridging, it is a nightmare. Yeah? Again, this is a Port Lewis pad, narrow channel, pinching the spine, very little pressure. Don't take my word, take the vital signs of the horse. The heart rate is up with two narrow gullets. Go with a saddle what is super narrow for the rider, has nice white bearing surface. This is the saddle what we, Schleese, won product of the year at Equitana in New Zealand, where you have a super wide channel, a super wide weight bearing surface for the horse, and a very narrow twist for the rider. So the modern horse from today needs a super wide channel to stay off the spine with lots of weight bearing surface. They're more sensitive. And I hope this made sense to you. And I hope you understand now the importance of proper saddle fit. Till next time, stay tuned. Thank you so much for staying in. Check us out on schleese.com. We have always many, many, many of webinars coming up and on our file. Bye for now. Thank you.